They call it a lifestyle disease, but it's a killer affecting 500 million people worldwide. In New Zealand, if you don't have type 2 diabetes, you'll probably know someone who does. What's certain is that you're paying for it. Type 2 diabetes is a massive epidemic. 250,000 Kiwis have it. The numbers have doubled over a decade, and increasingly younger people, even children, are being diagnosed. So what's gone wrong? Why is this mostly preventable disease out of control? John Hudson investigates.
Life's a juggle for Tash Anderson.
What are you hungry for?
She's studying towards a law degree and looking after little Lockie.
Come on.
He can be a handful.
Do you want me to carry you?
Especially when it's time for dinner.
Normally I get like fried rice and honey chicken from the noodle canteen.
Hi, can I order honey chicken and rice, please?
This is just one of her many takeaway options.
Six? Just in the one shopping complex thing. There's six of them.
Do you want nuggets? No.
They often go to the drive-thru.
Thank you.
McDonald's is an everyday thing almost.
Oh, I don't need the tray, thanks.
Because they're just down the road, so it's easy to get to McDonald's, Wendy's, KFC.
Thank you.
I live in a cabin at my grandparents', so it's hard to just... Sometimes I cook, but maybe that's probably once or twice a week if we're lucky.
But recently, Tash has had a very nasty fright.
To be honest, it's still sinking in.
She has the fastest spreading disease in New Zealand.
It's a silent killer, that it slowly breaks down your organs and stuff inside. That's about all I know.
Tash has type 2 diabetes.
What did your doctor say?
Just that I need to lose weight.
You're 154 kilos now.
Yeah.
What do you think a healthy weight for you is?
I think my ideal weight was in the 70s somewhere.
Right, half what you are,
yeah.
Less than half.
Yeah.
So what do you think you'll have to do?
I'm going to have to get myself into a routine, for starters.
Once, type 2 diabetes was considered an old person's illness, but Tash is only 30.
What do you know about the long-term problems you could encounter if your diabetes gets out of control?
Blindness. You can go blind. And your organs fail.
Kidney failure?
Yeah.
Yeah. Sores that turn into gangrene?
Yeah. No, I
don't. Limbs... being chopped off, dementia, way earlier than
normal. I don't know nothing. Like, I don't know any of those.
Diabetes could shorten Tash's life by decades, and she's not alone. A few kilometres from her South Auckland home, the Middlemore Hospital wards are full.
And it's incredibly expensive. It can't continue at this rate.
Diabetes specialist Brandon Orr-Walker has seen the expense of treating the disease blow out. Nationally, it's now more than $1 billion a year.
They're coming into hospital with heart attacks, infection of their skin, we call cellulitis, seeing them with things affecting the arteries, either their heart causing a heart attack or heart failure, affecting the arteries of their kidneys, bringing them into kidney failure.
Not everyone in this ward has type 2 diabetes, but many do. And for them, it's the ambulance at the bottom of the cliff.
I never felt sick. And one day I went to the doctors and they tested me and there it was.
Diana Mackay has had diabetes for years, but now her kidneys are failing.
I don't think I've done anything wrong. Now I'm here.
And how often are you here?
3 days a week. 3 days a week, 4 hours.
Today there are 157 diabetes patients like Diana in this hospital with a disease that can often be prevented.
The biggest factor is growing obesity, and that's the one that's preventable. It also appears much more in people who are of high deprivation.
Why does being poor increase your chances of obesity and therefore type 2 diabetes?
There are many cheap foodstuffs that are readily available in large amounts tend to be high in fat or sugar and salt. There are cheaper cuts of meat, and for poorer people with larger families, a cheaper cut of meat looks a very rational choice to make.
Come on.
For years, the rational choice for Tash has been cheap, convenient takeaways.
My parents were both working, so we're brought up on chips, hot chips and bread, pretty much every night.
Many people now do not know how to prepare their own food, and so pre-prepared food is very attractive. And pre-prepared food often has high amounts of sugar, salt and fat in it.
We'll come home and it's like pies and
lasagna toppers, ice creams, you know, like heaps of junk food.
That bad start led to Tasha's lifelong struggle with her weight.
These aren't people that have made a choice to be overweight or obese. They haven't made a choice to take, you know, bad quality foods. They are often very uncertain or even know no other way. This is just the food that they've got brought up on.
People in Tasha's neighbourhood are five times more likely than the general population to have type 2 diabetes.
I know so many people that have it, but yet they live normal lives, so I don't see it as a threat. I've never actually experienced anyone really being affected by it.
Type 2 often goes undiagnosed for years, and people who know they have it often don't appreciate the risks.
Where people know about the risk, it's viewed almost fatalistically rather than being something which would be avoidable for them.
But
now that Tash Anderson knows what type 2 diabetes could do to her, she's taking action.
My ultimate goal is to lose weight.
First thing you need to get down is your goals, right? What you're really wanting to achieve.
Tash's brother Daniel is a fitness instructor who wants to help.
Ever since we were younger, we all struggled with weight. It was like she got the worst of it. And then just hearing that she got diabetes, you know, it really means we need to do something, you know, quite soon. We want her to live longer and happier and more confident and comfortable, yeah.
After the break, Tash is heading in a new direction. Will she succeed?
And at schools like this one, they're starting to take control of the food environment.
It gets confiscated.
School kids dumping the junk food. Children as young as 8 are being diagnosed with type 2 diabetes, the result of childhood obesity. But some kids are fighting back.
They decided there was too much junk food.
A few years ago, Baird's Main Freight Primary School in South Auckland banned junk food.
We now have, I believe, fitter, healthier children, but it's not just down to the food.
Principal Alan Leith says the pressure for change didn't come from teachers or parents, it came from the pupils.
What was it about the junk food that they objected to?
It's going to sound funny, but they objected to the amount of litter caused by junk food as much as the actual food itself.
What are you having?
Can I have hot dog and popcorn?
Today the fatty pies and donuts have gone.
And we no longer have any juice. It's just supposed to be water and milk only.
So now you're a water and milk only school?
Yep. Yep.
And the ban on junk food goes well beyond the tuck shop.
Do you still have a problem with kids buying junk food and bringing it into school?
Yeah, we do. We have a dairy not far away and they sell what they call a lunch pack. And the lunch pack is really just junk. It's chippies and twisties and red water and it costs $2. I mean, he sells $1 pies as well, and I'm sure they don't have the Heart Foundation tick on them either.
If you see the junk food coming in, what happens?
It gets confiscated.
Yeah.
And we give them another lunch.
In theory, they all have healthy lunches, and no one goes hungry.
The community are very accepting of the policy. I've only had one person really question it.
Do you think there's a greater awareness with this generation about the effects of diabetes?
I don't think they think of it like that. I think they just think about it being fat or being overweight.
While Baird's Main Freight might be an oasis of healthy living, in the suburbs outside the school, more than 40,000 people now have type 2 diabetes.
If it's looking bad now, it's going to look a whole lot worse soon. We're going to have double the problem to deal with, double the cost of servicing and supporting people with diabetes, but we won't have double the, if you like, the funding.
It costs up to $100,000 a year to treat each patient with the illnesses caused by type 2 diabetes, and nearly a million Kiwis are now borderline diabetic. So anything inexpensive that prevents the disease progressing is well worth investigating. People like Kim Olivia are leading the way.
Technically I was obese, but I thought that I was normal, like everyone else does.
14 years ago, Kim was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes.
I changed my diet straight away and tried to lose a bit of weight, but I was told that wouldn't make any difference to my diabetes.
And at first, the disease did progress, so his doctor put him on medication.
And yet it's been shown pretty well for the last 10 years that there is actually an alternative without drugs.
The alternative is based on a British study of rapid weight loss. His doctor was sceptical.
He said, well, it won't make any difference, but it's no harm to try.
So he did.
I went from 104 to 81. Lost 20 kilograms in 10 weeks.
And that did it. That was enough.
That did it.
Kim's blood sugars fell dramatically.
I decided that I would have to change my lifestyle as well.
He began walking 2 hours a day, changed his diet.
It's mainly vegetables, raw foods, no processed foods if I can help it, and a minimum of carbohydrates. So no breakfast cereals, no toast, no bread with things, no sandwiches, no potatoes.
So what does that leave you? Meat, chicken, eggs?
Well, that leaves an awful lot of stuff, actually.
Can you do a bit of a dancing for me?
He then signed up for an international study of pre-diabetics, research aimed at discovering what can prevent people with elevated blood sugar levels progressing to the full-blown disease.
The people who attend the regular visits with the dietitians and have a good knowledge of how to have a good lifestyle in terms of diet and exercise.
Hooray.
Beautiful. Eventually, they'll be able to control their own behaviour and will be able to prevent type 2 diabetes.
So of that 250 people in your group, how many have gone on to develop type 2 diabetes?
Only 12.
Only 12?
Only 12.
Marta believes the key to controlling the disease without drugs is motivation.
It's having regular counselling from people who are giving consistent support to them and consistent information on a healthy lifestyle or lifestyle changes.
Kim Olivier was self-motivated, but he doesn't think he was anything special.
Over 90% of people have been just as successful as me, which means I'm not a superman. Anyone can do it with good supervision.
Kim now considers himself cured.
So he's gone from being diabetic,
yes,
to pre-diabetic and stayed there for 5 years.
Yes, yes.
Without any medication.
With no medication, just by diet and by controlling his diet and exercise patterns, which is great.
So if a 68-year-old mapping consultant from Auckland's North Shore can get rid of his diabetes, why is a tsunami of this disease threatening to overwhelm our health system?
10 years ago we had Let's Beat Diabetes, Healthy Eating, Healthy Action, and yet the number of type 2 diabetes cases has doubled. Why is that?
I think the enthusiasm for those approaches waned and the sponsorship to continue them was lost.
Why? The problem's getting worse and worse. Why has the enthusiasm waned?
I think that there was a philosophical belief that this was not something that really health needed to be involved in.
Doctors can diagnose and treat the disease, but not prevent it.
This is ultimately comes down to government. Government has to look after the interests of the populace. And so there needs to be approaches that can de-incentivise or take away the tendency of having excessive food.
A food tax?
Tax has to be part of it. It's a means that we're happy to use for virtually everything else. We're happy to use it for alcohol, cigarettes, for driving your car on the road. The difficulty, of course, with food is that we all do need to eat. It isn't discretionary.
But overeating cheap, energy-dense junk food is discretionary. And while overeating might be good for the fast food business, the illness it causes threatens to blow out our health budget.
You eat in your car, you eat on the run, you eat watching a movie, you eat in all sorts of environments.
And the more you do that, the harder it is to change.
It is, it's very habitual.
Overeaters like Tash Anderson know that only too well. In May, Tash decided she needed to change to lose half her body weight. But since then, there's been a shocking run of setbacks, family illness and a bereavement.
That sort of cut right across the regime that you were planning.
Yeah, so it's put me right back. So instead, I went ahead with going to the first appointment for bariatric surgery.
And that should get the weight off and hopefully the diabetes will disappear.
Exactly, yeah.
If her publicly funded stomach surgery does go ahead, it'll cost $11,000. Tash will have to lose some weight first.
But in the meantime, you're sticking with the noodles.
Yes, I am. Guilty.
Well, schools are rapidly getting the message about obesity and type 2 diabetes. Fewer than 5% allow the sale of sugary fizzy drinks. And this week, students and staff at two Christchurch schools went a step further, calling for limits to selling fast food near schools.